A very good morning to all my dear students and listeners. Today we are going to discuss about the drafting of writ petitions under the subject captioned as drafting, pleading and convincing. My dear students, as you all are aware that the relevant provisions for drafting writ petitions have been given under Article 32 and 226 of the Constitution of India. As such, for the better understanding of today's topic, that is drafting of writ petitions, one must have a very sound knowledge of these articles so as to apply them for drafting a writ petition. As such, before starting with today's lecture, I just want to recapitulate the law relating to writ petitions. My dear students, as you all are aware that writ jurisdiction is exercised by the Supreme Court under Article 32 and by the High Court under Article 226 of the Constitution of India. Article 32 and Article 226 provides judicial remedies of a summary nature for the enforcement of fundamental rights of two articles, that is 32 and 226. The former is the more important one as a constitutional safeguard of fundamental rights. The writs are obviously intended to enable the High Court or the Supreme Court to issue them in grave cases. Article 32 of the Constitution of India gives the right to move the Supreme Court by appropriate proceedings for enforcement of the rights conferred by Part 3 of the Constitution of India. Article 32 of the Constitution of India reads as under. 32 provides remedies for the enforcement of rights conferred by this part, Clause 1. The right to move the Supreme Court shall by appropriate proceeding for the enforcement of the right conferred by this part is guaranteed. Clause 2. The Supreme Court shall have the power to issue directions or orders or writs, including writs in the nature of habeas corpus, mandamus, prohibition, quo warranto, and certiorari, whichever may be appropriate for the enforcement of any of the rights conferred by this part. Clause 3. Without prejudice to the powers conferred on the Supreme Court by clauses 1 and 2, Parliament may by law empower any other court to exercise within the local limits of its jurisdiction all or any of the powers exercisable by the Supreme Court under Clause 2. The right guaranteed by this article shall not be suspended except as otherwise provided by this constitution. My dear students, the sole object of Article 32 is the enforcement of fundamental rights guaranteed by this constitution. The right to move the Supreme Court is only available when the fundamental rights are infringed or are likely to be taken away or abridged. Clause 1 of Article 32 guarantees to every person the right to move the Supreme Court by appropriate proceedings for the enforcement of the rights conferred by this part, that is Part 3 of the Constitution. Article 32 does not merely confer power on the Supreme Court as Article 226 does on the High Court to issue writs for the enforcement of the rights conferred by Part 3 of the Constitution of India or for any other purpose as part of its general principles. Or its general jurisdiction. The rights provided guaranteed remedy for the enforcement of those rights, and this remedial right is itself a fundamental right by being included in Part 3. The jurisdiction conferred on the Supreme Court by Article 32 is not concurrent with the one given to High Courts by Article 226. The state cannot place any hindrance in the way of an aggrieved person seeking to approach the Supreme Court. This is logical enough for it is against state action that fundamental rights are claimed. Further, as you all are aware that there are 5 prerogative writs, meaning thereby extraordinary writs guaranteed by the sovereign, that is the state, as a fountain of justice due to inadequate legal remedies. It may be noted that high courts have wider powers under Article 226 of the Constitution with regard to the writs, for they may issue writs either for the purpose of enforcing fundamental rights or a statutory or a legal right or to remedy a breach of statutory duty on the part of the authorities. But the Supreme Court can only issue these writs for the enforcement of fundamental rights. The existence of a judicially enforceable right available for enforcement is a condition precedent for invoking the writ jurisdiction of the court. It is implicit in the exercise of such extraordinary jurisdiction that the relief prayed for must be one to enforce a legal right. In fact, the existence of such right is the foundation of the exercise of the said jurisdiction by the court. A legal right means an entitlement arising out of legal rules. The legal right that can be enforced must ordinarily be the right of the appellant himself, who complains of infraction of such right and approaches the court for relief as regards the same. The expression aggrieved person denotes an elastic and elusive concept. It cannot be confined within the bounds of a rigid, exact, and comprehensive definition. But it is clear that the expression person aggrieved does not include a person who suffers from a psychological or an imaginary injury. A person aggrieved must therefore necessarily be one whose right or interest has been adversely affected or jeopardized. However, in the exceptional circumstances, if the actual persons aggrieved because of ignorance, illiteracy, inarticulation or poverty are unable to approach the court, and a person who has no personal agenda or object in relation to which he can grind his own axe approaches the court, then the court may examine the issue, and in exceptional circumstances, even if his bona fides are doubted, but the issue raised by him in the opinion of the court requires consideration, the court may proceed suo motu in such respect. So there are five writs which may be issued, and one such writ is that of habeas corpus. Habeas corpus means to have a body. Habeas corpus is a writ requiring the body of a person to be brought before a judge or court. In other words, it is a prerogative process for securing the liberty of the subject, which affords an effective means of immediate relief from unlawful, unjustifiable detention, whether in prison or in private custody. It is an ancient Supreme Court, supreme right of the subject. Its object is the vindication of the right of the personal liberty of the subject. The writ of habeas corpus is the oldest writ evolved by common law of England, thereby to protect the individual liberty against its invasion in the hands of executive, or maybe also at the instance of private person. So from this, my dear student, we may infer that the writ of habeas corpus is not only available or invoked against the state, but also against the private individuals. So this is one of the difference between this type, this writ, and other four writs provided under the relevant provisions of the Constitution. Now I would like to go further. Second writ is mandamus. As far as the mandamus is concerned, it means a command. It is a high prerogative writ of a most extensive remedial nature. The Supreme Court and the High Court have the power, respectively, under Article 32 and under Article 226 of the Constitution, to issue this writ in the form of a command directing any person holding public office under the government or statutory body or corporation or to an inferior court exercising judicial or quasi judicial function to do a particular act pertaining to his office or duty and which the court issuing the writ considers to be the right of the petitioner and is in the interest of justice. It is not restricted to persons charged with judicial or quasi judicial duty thereof. So from this we may infer that mandamus means the command, and the same can be filed under Article 32 and 226. Further, where there is an other alternative remedy provided under different statutes, then this writ cannot be filed in a court of law. Further, this writ can only be filed when there is a specific legal right, but no specific legal remedy to enforce that right has been provided under any of the statute. Next, the other writs are certiorari. As far as the writ of certiorari is concerned, it may be issued to any judge, magistrate or person or body of persons or authority vested with judicial or quasi-judicial function. An order of certiorari is an order directing the aforesaid authority and requiring them to transmit the record of the proceeding in any cause or matter to the High Court to be dealt with there. It may be issued when the decision complained of is of an authority having the legal duty to act judicially or quasi-judicially, and the authority has either no jurisdiction or there is an excess of jurisdiction. It is mainly issued for quashing decisions containing errors of law. The other type of writ is writ of prohibition. My dear students, the writ of prohibition is an order directing to an inferior court or tribunal forbidding such court or tribunal from continuing with the proceedings of any cause or matter. It is an appropriate writ to restrain a tribunal which threatens to assume a jurisdiction not vested in it, as so long as there is something in the proceedings left to prohibit. The difference between the writ of prohibition and certiorari is that former is issued to restrain a tribunal from doing an act before it is actually done, while the latter may be issued during the course of the proceedings of an act and even after the act is done and the proceeding is concluded. Now the last writ is that of quo warranto. It is a writ questioning a right of a person holding of an office of a public nature and directs him to show an authority under which he is holding such office or exercising the right. Now I would like to go further. What are the form and the contents to be contained in a writ petition? So my dear students, following are the points which you please keep in mind while drafting a writ. First, the writ must conform to the statutory provisions as laid down under the law. Second, it must conform to the statutory provisions. Third, full particulars of wrongs and injustices should be stated in the petition. Further, grounds on which the issuance of the writ petition is applied for. In the drafting of the writ petition, one must mention that there is no other legal remedy available to him. Further, the writ must also contain the relief or the prayer, as the case may be, and the same maybe must be signed and verified by the petitioner as well as his counsel. So this is all about the today's topic. But before parting with today's topic, I just want to apprise you with my new topic, which I am going to take in my next class. And the new topic which I am going to take in my next class is on civil pleadings. Thank you very much. We'll meet you soon in my next lecture. Till then, stay home, stay safe, and stay healthy.